Good morning. Welcome to worship at St. James. We're grateful that you've chosen to join us for this time of worship and praise, of prayer, and time in God's Word together. We pray the Lord blesses you richly as we share the time of worship together this morning. Before we begin, I want to share a few important announcements with you. As always, we want to encourage you to go to our website, our Facebook page, so you can stay up to date with all the happenings here at St. James. And on the website, you can look at our weekly bulletin as well and read the information on that. A couple of important things to share with you as well regarding our schedule. On February 17th is Ash Wednesday, and we will be having two in-person worship services. We'll be celebrating the Lord's Supper at both of those services. One will be at 11 o'clock a.m. in the morning, and then one at 6:30 p.m. Ash Wednesday evening right here in the sanctuary for both of those services. And then the 6:30 p.m. service will be broadcast on the radio as well. Our midweek Lenten services will be recorded services similar to what we did for the season of Advent, a time of prayer and reflection, Bible study, worship, and meditation. We invite you to join us for those. The theme this year is Cries of the Passion, and they'll be available on our Facebook page and on our YouTube channel as well on that Wednesday beginning at 3:30 in the afternoon. We'll also be broadcasting those at 6:30 in the evening on the radio. Then one more important item, we will be having a voters meeting on Sunday, February 21st at 11:45, and it'll be here in the sanctuary. And I just encourage you to check out that online bulletin, and you can get the agenda to see everything that will be a part of that very important meeting for our life together as we move forward as God's people in mission here at St. James. With that, it's time for us to turn our attention to the Lord and begin our time of worship with our opening hymn, Sing Praise to the God of Israel. Worship in the presence of our God, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Since we are gathered to hear God's word, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Hear God's good news for you today. Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His only Son to die for you, and for His sake forgives you all of your sins. Because of that, with great assurance, I announce to you that God has forgiven you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. O God, in the glorious transfiguration of your beloved Son, you confirm the mysteries of the faith by the testimony of Moses and Elijah. In the voice that came from the bright cloud, you wonderfully foreshowed our adoption by grace. Mercifully, make us co-heirs with the King in His glory, and bring us to the fullness of our inheritance in heaven through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We give our attention now to the readings from God's Word for this Sunday of the Transfiguration. The Old Testament reading is from the book of Exodus and the 34th chapter. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony in his hand, as he came down from the mountain, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. Aaron and all the people of Israel saw Moses, and behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses talked with them. Afterward, all the people of Israel came near, and he commanded them all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. And when Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil over his face. Whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would remove the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the people of Israel what he was commanded, the people of Israel would see the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face was shining. And Moses would put the veil over his face again until he went in to speak with God. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, beginning in the third chapter. St. Paul writes, "Since we have such a hope, we are very bold, not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not gaze at the outcome of what was being brought to an end. But their minds were hardened. For to this day, when they read the Old Covenant, the same veil remains unlifted, because only through Christ is it taken away. Yet to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart, but we have renounced disgraceful and underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled only to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." This is the word of the Lord. Our holy gospel reading is from the Gospel of Mark in the 9th chapter. "And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And Jesus was transfigured before them. His clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, 'Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make 3 tents, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah.' For he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And a cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud, 'This is my beloved Son. Listen to him.' And suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them, but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead." This is the gospel of the Lord.
good morning. And I'd just like to invite you all, especially the kids, to take an opportunity to look at that story again that Pastor Steve shared about Jesus on the mountain, and actually that we just sang through with that hymn. It's good to be here, Lord. Jesus went up onto the mountain, and that's interesting because that's often where the Lord comes, to be with his people on top of mountains. And while he's there, it says that he was transfigured, he was transformed, he was changed. That Jesus, who looked every bit like a human, took on a different form, or at least a different appearance. He was shining with the brightness of God's glory. We got a glimpse, a little glimpse, of his true nature of being God as well. And so did the disciples. And you heard that they were terrified because with Jesus were these two Old Testament men who had already been with the Lord, Moses and Elijah. And then as Peter begins to blurt out, doesn't even know what he's trying to say, it said that a cloud surrounded them. That's often in the Old Testament an echo about God's glory. It comes down and it surrounds them. And then out of the cloud comes God's voice. The same voice that we heard when Jesus was baptized, with almost the same words. "This is my son," the voice said. "With him I'm well pleased. Listen to him." This week I was talking with the seventh graders about that story and that voice and the echoes that it tells us. It tells us a lot about Jesus. "This is my son." It's a word about Jesus being a king. So I asked the seventh graders, well, what does it mean to be a king? Well, it means you live in a palace, you have luxury, people do things for you, and that's really what it does mean for most. But not for Jesus. Because the next phrase that the voice said was, "With him I'm well pleased," that's another echo from the Old Testament that points to Jesus being what the Old Testament would say is the servant of God, the servant of the Lord. So he's a king who doesn't come to get served, but Jesus will say it, he comes to serve. And that's his glory. That's the real glory of God, that God gives love. And that's the glory that Jesus will show. And he'll show us just much how much he loves us. Maybe you've seen this before, because this is how much Jesus loves us. That he's willing to come down from that mountain to a different mountain, to the mountain where Jesus' hands would be spread out this far and put on a cross to show us God's love, to give us God's love, that we could be changed by the glory of God into the likeness of Jesus himself. So that's what we're going to talk about. So I really encourage you to keep listening for those images of the glory of God showing up in the person of Jesus. So, Lord, it's good to be here. The word to encourage us today on this Transfiguration Day is from that letter that we shared from 2 Corinthians 3 and 4. But I'm going to especially focus in on just one verse, verse 18, and I'd like you to hear it again. Paul writes, "And all of us with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being changed, are being transformed by that glory into the same likeness, namely, to the very same glory which comes from the Lord." This is his word. You know, it's funny how people looking at the same thing can see things differently. When it snows 10 inches, you might look at that and see a nuisance. You might see a sore back. But others who just got a snowmobile or who have skis waiting in storage, they see 10 inches of snow. That's a good day. We see things differently, even though it's the same thing that we see. So when the apostle named Paul looked at this congregation in Corinth, what did he see? And what did those people, the Corinthians, see when they looked at this missionary pastor named Paul? Well, How did the people of that congregation see this man named Paul, this missionary pastor? Well, here's the truth. Many of them didn't consider him to be a legitimate apostle of Jesus. They insinuated Paul's words couldn't be trusted. Others looked at him as being greedy, as a money-hungry person. They looked down on him because, in their view, he wasn't a very gifted speaker. And the fact that he was so often beaten, so often jailed, and so often suffering, it caused them to see Paul as really a failure. That's how they saw this great missionary. Well, if you would look at the congregation in Corinth, well, what would we see? What would the average Corinthian churchgoer be like? Well, let me tell you. They were divided. They were divided into factions over which part of the ministry they would support. In an over-sexualized culture that they lived in, it contaminated their daily living with immorality as well. Members of this church, they brought lawsuits against one another. They bickered over rules and regulations. They gossiped. They gossiped mainly about their pastors, their spiritual leaders. They were puffed up with self-righteous pride, thinking that they were better Christians than others because of the simple gifts that they believed had come from God. Some of the people in this church, they even doubted the news of Jesus being raised from the dead. So when Paul looked at this people, when Paul looked at the people of this congregation, what did he see? Well, let's take a look at the text. That's verse 18, and it's a remarkable verse. Here's what Paul says he sees. "And all of us with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed by that glory into the same likeness, namely, to the very same glory which comes from the Lord." So what is it that Paul saw? What does he see? He sees these people, and he says, "I see the glory of the Lord." That's what he said he sees. And what did Paul want them to see when they looked at him? He wanted the same thing. He wanted them to see the glory of the Lord as reflected in a mirror. Isn't that amazing? When Paul looks at these people that I described to you in this church, he says he sees the glory of the Lord above and beyond them. And when they look at him, this beat-up, suffering apostle, he wants them to see the glory of God as well. And that phrase, the glory of the Lord, it's an echo from the language of Jesus himself. In John's gospel, John tells the arrival of Jesus with these words. He said, "And the Word became flesh, and he dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only." That seeing the glory of the Lord in each other wasn't because they were super Christians. Remember the description that I gave to you of them? They weren't at all. To see the glory of the Lord in one another, well, Paul is saying that this glory of the Lord is because God has been at work in them. It's that glory that comes from the Lord. Now, in John's gospel also, early in his ministry, Jesus would keep on saying this phrase. He would keep on telling the disciples and anybody, "My time has not yet come. My time has not yet come." When he's asked to change water into wine, to do the miracle at the wedding, Jesus tells, "My time has not yet come." But then, when he finally enters into Jerusalem in his last week, Jesus looks around and sees what's happening, and then he says this phrase, "My time has now come. My time has come for me to be glorified, to show the glory of God." And so what happens to Jesus for him to be glorified? he gets nailed to the cross. He gets put on the tree for the sins of the world. There's the glory of the Lord. The glory of the Lord is Jesus. And it's the good news that Jesus brings. And then on this mountain of transfiguration, where he is transformed, where his appearance is changed, it doesn't stay that way. The moment dissipates. And when the disciples look up after the cloud is gone, Mark said they only saw Jesus. And he comes down that mountain, telling his disciples not to tell anyone of what they have just seen until after the resurrection, because his time had not yet come. His glory isn't from his power. It isn't from his divine authority. Jesus' glory comes from what he's willing to do for us. And that's the heart of the good news that he brings. That God loves us no matter what we look like. God loves us no matter what we do. That Jesus came for the sick, not for the healthy. Jesus came for the sinners, not for the righteous. That God is at heart the God of total self-giving love. Which is why Jesus will come down from that mountain. He won't stay up on there like Peter asked him. He'll come down from that mountain of transfiguration and set his face to go towards the next mountain. That mountain with the cross on the top. And this good news of God's love for us, no matter what we look like, it does have a purpose. In the text, it's because God wants to change us. That's what Paul was telling us. The Lord wants us to be transformed. And I've said this line before. He wants us to be transformed so that we look just like Jesus. That's what reflecting the glory of God is. Let's look at the second part of that verse 18 again. Where Paul is saying, and we are being changed, we are being transformed by that glory of Jesus, into the same likeness. Namely, to the very same glory which comes from the Lord. Transformed. Changed. We can be changed. It's a process. It's not just an event. And we can be changed. See, I'm not a cat person, not at all. I even have a little cartoon book that was given to me. It's called 101 Ways to Kill a Cat. About 16 years ago, lo and behold, though, a cat came to live in our house. Rumor has it that I even was known to pet that cat. Yeah, we can be changed. But there's a greater change. Jesus said it this way, this greater change. You were dead, but now you are alive. You were lost, but now you have been found. You were ugly. You were stained with sin and shame, but now you reflect the glory of the Lord. And we all need that change. We need that change from being me-focused to God-focused, to other-focused. So how do we get bumped off of self-centeredness? How do we get this me-focus to be changed to God-focused? Well, maybe attend a seminar. Try reading a book. Maybe just spend a little more time in prayer. No. None of those work. We're moved from being me-focused to God-focused as the Spirit of the Lord works in us. I mean, notice Paul's language that he uses in this passage. It's a passive language. We are being transformed. We aren't transforming. We are being changed. We're not the ones doing it. It's being done to us. Transformation into the likeness of Jesus is what God wants. It's what God desires. It's what God's leading us towards, but we don't produce it. It's the Spirit of the Lord working in us. You know, there's a basic principle of spirituality that says this, and here it is. You become like what you worship. That's this principle. You become like what you worship. So take a look at this cartoon. This little cartoon. There's a wife who's looking at her husband. He's sitting in the chair in front of the TV, but he's been transformed. He's been transformed into a football with a big G on it. And she's saying, "I told you this would happen someday." You see, the cartoon's simple little truth is we become like what we worship. We become like what we worship. God's intent for us who are loved by Jesus, who trust in Jesus, is to be reflecting the glory of the Lord because we're being transformed more and more from one degree of glory to another to be like Jesus. So my question is, are you? Are you being transformed, and if you are, into what? If what we become is what we worship, what are you being transformed into? Into his likeness with an ever-increasing glory to be just like Jesus? So I have one more question for each of you. Anything happening in your life? Are you being changed more and more into that likeness of Jesus? And if not, why not? Think about it. Yeah, I have the goal of trying to always lose a little bit of weight and staying in best shape that I can, so that I can keep remaining being active and keep being productive. And guess what? Simply wanting that to be doesn't mean that those changes will happen. That's why I get up and I go to a gym 4 to 5 mornings a week to exercise, to work out for the purpose of that goal. In the same way, to be transformed, to be changed by God, by the Spirit, into the likeness of Jesus with an ever-increasing glory, to be just like him, that's what God wants. And I pray that that's what you want too. But it just doesn't happen. What's the spiritual exercise then? Well, it's learning from Jesus. It's learning from Jesus, which means being present with Jesus. Lord, it's good to be here. Being present with Jesus, listening to Jesus, hearing his word, learning from Jesus, coming to the table of Jesus for what Jesus can give to us. We become what we worship. Maybe you've heard this before. I've heard it. You know, I get just as much out of worship being out in the woods, or I get just as much being worship being on a lake as anything else. Now, I fully understand how we can appreciate those experiences and how those moments can be meaningful. But really think about it. When was the last time that a tree died for you? When was the last time a fish on the end of a hook restores you to the wholeness of life. You become like what you worship. And in the end, let's have Jesus not say, "I told you this would happen." You see, out of great love, Jesus placed himself on a tree for us, in our place. That's the glory of the Lord. So that as we worship that Jesus, as we trust in that Jesus, as we learn from that Jesus, as we receive forgiveness from that Jesus, the amazing thing is we become more like that Jesus, reflecting his glory to one another. That's what the mission, that's what the ministry of missionary Pastor Paul was all about. He was all about reflecting the glory of the Lord to his people so that they would see in them, he could see in them this loving God at work. Here's Paul's work, basically telling the Corinthians, "I brought you God's good news of Jesus your Savior. You've seen his glory reflected in me." And now he says, now I see it being reflected in you. And the ministry of St. James, it can't be anything less. And it's happening when we have a bunch of teachers who gather Monday through Friday with 200 students. There is something to be seen. It's the glory of the Lord reflecting as we're being transformed into the likeness of Jesus. It's happening when students gathering in the landing to be anchored in our youth ministry, or when little ones gather together in Sunday school, or when parents decide coming to a workshop to help prepare their kids for something like communion is worth the time. There's something to be seen in that. The glory of the Lord reflecting as we're being transformed into the likeness of the one we worship. And it's why we gather in this time for worship. It's coming into the presence of Jesus. It's not just checking something off the box. It's coming into the presence of Jesus, who promised to be here for us in the means that he promises to offer this amazing gift that we call his grace, that we're loved by Jesus. We're being transformed then to share the likeness of the one we worship. Oh, and there is a finality for all of it too. A finality of this transformation. We get a glimpse of it as Jesus is there transfigured with Moses and Elijah. But here's the promise of that transformation in its finality. It comes from Paul again, from Philippians 3. He said, "Join together in following my example, brothers and sisters. And just as you have us as a model, keep your eyes on those who live as we do. For as often as I've told you before, and now tell you again, even with tears, many are living as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach. Their glory is in their shame. Their mind is set on earthly things." Think of that football sitting in the chair. "See, I told you it would happen one day." But our citizenship, Paul said, is in heaven. And we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who, by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform. Did you hear it? Will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. To be transformed into the likeness of Jesus. So until that day, Lord, it's good to be here. And all of us with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed now by that glory into the same likeness, namely, to the very same glory which comes from the Lord. In that name of Jesus. Amen. And may the peace of God that does transcend all understanding always guard your hearts and your minds in Christ our Lord.
I invite you now to join me as we confess our Christian faith together using this morning the words of the Apostles' Creed, words by which we confess our faith in the one true God to whom all glory, honor, and praise is due. We confess together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We join our hearts together in prayer. It is so good for us to be here, Lord. And we thank you that once again you have opened our eyes and opened the eyes of our hearts to behold your glory once again. To hear those words of confirmation from you, Father, that this Jesus is your beloved Son. You call upon us to listen to him. We thank you that by your Holy Spirit, you open our ears to hear and to receive the truth of Jesus. That the glory of God is seen in him. Yes, on this Mount of Transfiguration. But more importantly than that, you have caused us to see the glory of God on Mount Calvary, in the darkness of his suffering, in his death, so that we could catch a glimpse of the depth of his great love for us, that we might not die in our sins, languish in our sins through life, but that we might be transformed from death to life, from lost to found, from guilty to forgiven. Lord, help us to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Lord, help us to answer the call to spend time with Jesus, to be present with Jesus, to listen to Jesus, to receive from Jesus all that he desires to give us, that more and more we become more like Jesus, reflecting his mercy and his grace and his love, sharing his truth and his hope and his promises with one and all, transforming us together as your people to become that people that are leading all people to Jesus, that they might behold his glory and his grace, and they would join us in saying, Lord, it is so good for us to be here, to come before you in worship and to hear your word. And Lord, we thank you for the grace that you give us in bringing our prayers before you like this, that we can pour out our hearts to you. You hear our every prayer, and you promise to answer our every prayer in a way that is good for us, helps us to become more like Jesus, and most of all, brings glory to you. Lord, we pray for our brothers and sisters in Jesus, some who maybe long for that mountaintop, but they've been making their way through a valley of shadows and darkness, the threats of disease and death, of suffering, of sadness. Shine upon them the glory of your grace, your goodness, and your love. Bring to them a measure of hope and healing and help, we pray this day. As we continue to bring before you Rita Mady and Ron Schrader, Betty Klitsky and Marion Maltby, Samantha Herman and Virginia Hess, Sarah Sumnick, Rory Buss, Sharon Passon, Mark Brown, and Marlon Springer, and those we name in our hearts. Lord, bless these your servants today with a glimpse of the glory of Jesus, their Savior, who is with them and who loves them. Fill their hearts with peace and hope and joy. We gather up all our prayers now, and we bring them before your throne of glorious grace in the name of Jesus, praying as our beloved Jesus has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now receive the Lord's blessing upon you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.
And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.